Hello friends, welcome to Engineering Simplified. Today we are going to learn about external stability of retaining wall. This topic is very much important as it is the first step of designing a new retaining wall and analyzing an existing retaining wall. Why we need to study this topic? Why? Before studying anything, we should know why we need it. It is the first step. External stability analysis is the first step of designing. The dimensions of various parts of a retaining wall is decided basing upon its external stability. After studying this topic, we can understand what are the forces which causes the retaining wall to fail, and what are the forces which counteract the effect of destabilizing forces and keep the structure stable. And after this video, we can analyze an existing retaining wall if there is any structural and environmental changes occur. Just consider, there is an existing retaining wall. After 2 or 3 years, we want to build a house on the backfill. Due to the overburden of this house, is the retaining wall will fail or it will be stable? After studying this chapter, we can analyze it. Once we found out the dimension of the various parts of the retaining wall so that it will be externally stable, we go for internal stability. That is the check for stability against internal forces like flexures, shear and the reinforcement, and if there is a need of changing dimension, it is done accordingly. The retaining wall should be stable against overturning. That means it should not overturn. It should not rotate. It should be safe against vertical pressure. The vertical pressure exerted by the foundation on the soil should be within permissible limit, and the foundation should not lift from the soil. And it should be stable against sliding. That is, the wall should not slide due to the external horizontal forces. First, we study about the stability against overturning. There is a chances there. The wall will rotate by its toe. This is the toe portion. There is a chance that the wall will rotate by its toe due to the action of forces. As shown in the figure, the anti-clockwise movement about the toe will cause the wall to overturn. While analyzing the retaining wall, we consider the soil above the hill as a part of the retaining wall. Okay. The active earth pressure creates the anticlockwise movement, that is the overturning movement. And the what are the movement which resist the overturning movement? To counteract this overturning movement about the toe, sufficient amount of restoring movement. Restoring movement is in the clockwise direction, should be developed. The restoring movement is due to the dead load of the retaining wall and the dead load of the soil above the hill portion. These two loads provides clockwise movement, that is restoring movement, and The active earth pressure provides anti-clockwise movement. Indian Standard Code of Practice, IS 456-2000, suggests that what should be the restoring movement so as to counteract the overturning movement. The clause 20.1, page 33 of IS 456, states that the stability of a structure as a whole against overturning shall be ensured so that the restoring moment shall not be less than the sum of 1.2 times maximum overturning moment due to characteristic dead load and 1.4 times the maximum overturning moment due to characteristics imposed load. In cases where dead load provides the restoring moment, only 0.9 times the characteristic dead load shall be considered. Restoring moment due to imposed load shall be ignored. So, the code suggests that the restoring moment should be less than 1.2 times the overturning moment if the overturning moment is due to dead load. And it should be less than 1.4 times the overturning moment if the overturning moment is due to imposed load. The active earth pressure is an imposed load. So, moment of resistance should be less than equal to 1.4 times of overturning moment. Okay. H. The course also suggests that if the resisting moment, is by dead load, then the resisting it should be reduced by 10% for safety. Okay. Therefore, the resisting moment or the restoring moment should be multiplied by 0.9 as we are reducing it by 10%. Okay. The ratio of the 0.9 times of restoring moment and overturning moment, that is just destabilizing moment, should be greater than 1.4. So, factor of safety against overturning is the ratio of restoring moment by overturning moment or the ratio of stabilizing moment by destabilizing moment, which will be greater than 1.4 by 0.9, that is 1.55. When the overturning moment will be more than, there will be rotation about the toe. Okay. What are the stabilizing moment and destabilizing moment? The forces due to the dead load of the structure and the dead load of the soil above the hill region creates the stabilizing moment. Okay. And what is the destabilizing moment? The destabilizing moment is due to the active earth pressure, which is in this figure, it is in anti-clockwise direction. And the stabilizing moment is in clockwise direction. The retaining wall should have enough friction between the base of the foundation. There should be enough friction generated between the base of the foundation and the soil so that the wall should not slide due to action of external horizontal force. The earth pressure will try to push the soil or to push the retaining wall. The resisting force against the sliding is developed due to friction between base of the foundation and soil. It should be sufficient to counteract the pushing force by earth pressure, otherwise the wall will fail due to sliding. IS 456-2000 suggests what should be the resisting force to counteract the pushing force. Here also, the structure shall have a factor against sliding of not less than 1.4 under most adverse combination of applied characteristic snow forces. In this case also, the characteristic load is reduced by 10%. That means the resisting force is multiplied by 0.9 times. So the factor of safety against sliding will be greater, should be greater than 1.55 for safety against sliding. Till now, we understood that the sliding force is due to the horizontal component of active earth pressure. Then what is the value of the resisting force? From the engineering mechanics, we know that frictional force is the frictional force is the multiplication of coefficient friction into normal force. The normal force is the summation of total weight, the total vertical component. In case of returning wall, the normal force is the total vertical forces. Total vertical forces due to the weight of the structure, along with if there is any overburden over the hill or the toe. And we take the coefficient of friction as 10 of delta. Delta is the angle of friction between the soil and foundation. Generally, we can take the value of delta as 2/3 of phi. Phi is the angle of internal friction of soil if there is no delta value given. Due to the action of vertical and horizontal forces, base pressure develops below the foundation. The base pressure should be such that the foundation should not fail. The resultant of all the vertical and horizontal forces should pass in such a point through the base of the foundation that the hill should not lift from the soil. That means there should not be any tension in this hill region. For this condition, the resultant should fall middle third of the base width. If the total base width will be B, then the resultant should pass in the middle B3 region. This rule is called middle third rule. Let the resultant of all the forces is acting at a distance of E from the midpoint. Okay, let's say the width of the slab is D. Okay, this is the midpoint, that is point D, which is D/2. The resultant forces are the two components, one horizontal and vertical, RG and RH. It is acting at a point E from the midpoint at a distance of E. The E is called eccentricity. The maximum base pressure, from this we can find out the maximum and minimum base pressure. Okay. The load is acting at an eccentricity of E from mid depth. It has a two components, one vertical component, one horizontal component. Okay. Then we can find out the maximum bearing component, maximum bearing pressure which is occurring at toe and minimum bearing pressure which is occurring at heel. So the maximum bearing pressure is equal to the vertical component of resultant divided by the base width B plus 1 plus 6 times of eccentricity by B. The maximum bearing pressure should be less than equal to allowable bearing capacity of soil. What is the bearing capacity of soil? This is the maximum bearing pressure a soil can take. If the bearing pressure is more than the allowable bearing pressure of the soil, then the soil will fail due to shear failure. Sometimes we also take uneven settlement as a limit to find out the Q max value. What should be the minimum bearing pressure? The minimum bearing pressure is Rv, total vertical component of the resultant force, divided by base width into 1 minus 6 times eccentricity into base width. Okay. As I have told you previously, the hill should not lift up. In hard condition, the hill will lift up when there will be a tension developed in the hill region. So that the Q minimum should always be greater than zero. That also that in hill always should the compression prevails. So what should be the minimum E value so that the Q minimum should be greater than zero? Let's say Q minimum is zero, then 1 minus 6 E by B equal to zero. So E equal to B by 6. So the eccentricity, so if the base width of the return wall is B, the eccentricity, and this is the midway with B by 2, the resultant should be between both sides B by 6 and B by 6, so as to avoid any tension developed in hill region. Okay, so this proves that the eccentricity should be in the middle third width. The resultant should pass in this middle third base width region. In this video, we learned about the factors affecting stability of the retaining wall, and we know how to do the stability check. If you like this video, don't forget to subscribe to this channel. If you have any doubt regarding, you can comment below. Thank you.